Hello, and welcome back to another session of BHA Live, an ongoing series of educational opportunities being hosted by Barbershop Harmony Australia's Harmony Academy. If this is your first session, welcome. Sit back and relax and enjoy tonight's presentation. And of course, a big welcome back to those who have already had a chance to experience one of our Friday night sessions. Now, before I get started, I'll get a little bit of technical housekeeping out of the way. If you've joined us via Zoom, please feel free to use the chat function to talk amongst yourselves. However, if you have a specific question about anything being presented, please make sure you submit that via the Q&A function. This will make sure that the questions all funnel through and get seen. We have a great session in store for you tonight. This session is called Uncovering Your Music and will be hosted by the one and only Alex Morris. Now, Alex completed a Bachelor of Music in Composition at the University of Western Australia in 2009. Since then, he has been active working with orchestras, arts companies and festivals, currently holding the position of General Manager with the Stonington Symphony. Alex is in demand around the world as a vocal coach, working with ensembles, teaching classes and running workshops with regular appearances as faculty at the BHS Harmony University. Alex is a former music director of Vocal Evolution, leading them to 3 Barbershop Harmony Australia gold medals. Since moving to Melbourne, Alex has taken on the role of music director with Geelong Harmony Chorus from Sweet Adelines, Australia, as well as music director and co-producer of Shania Choir and Shout Youth Chorus. Alex is a member of the Sweet Adelines Australia Regional Education Faculty and the BHA Education Faculty. Alex has held the position of Chair of the Australasian Guild of Barbershop Judges, Vice President Music and Vice President Contest and Judging. In 2013, Alex became the first non-North American certified Barbershop Harmony Society music judge. He's a sought-after arranger and is regularly commissioned to write new works and arrangements and sells his music to ensembles around the world. Now let's get this show on the road. It's my great pleasure to hand you over to tonight's presenter, Alex Morris.
Thank you so much, Dan, and thank you to BHA for having me once again on this wonderful series of presentations that is BHA Live every Friday night during isolation, where I am now back in, unfortunately, being in the wonderful city of Melbourne. I am back in isolation as of yesterday. So day 2, we're going okay, but we're coping here in Melbourne. Obviously, things have changed quite a bit, but it's great to see so many people out there still logging on to this wonderful resource that BHA is putting together for our Friday night series. Tonight's a session that I call Uncovering Your Music. As a music judge, it's always my joy and pleasure to try and pass on a bit of my experience and knowledge around how I have learned to develop and interpret my music. And over the years, I've learned from some wonderful people who've definitely helped shape this presentation for me. So this is kind of a way of unpacking your music as a musical roadmap for a destination that is some kind of connection with yourself, with the music, and with the audience. So I'm going to put a PowerPoint slide up on the screen. There's also quite a lot of audio through this presentation this evening. If you are all experiencing very loud audio, please do let me know, because during a test earlier it was a little loud. However, I will try and control our volume as we go. There'll be a couple of moments whereby I'm going to ask a couple of questions as well. So it'd be great if you could submit those, just so that we can get an idea of what people's responses are to the various questions that we have during the session. All right, I'm going to share my screen with you now, and we'll get started. So just a bit of an overview on this presentation. I'm going to go through a few of my observations around what I've seen and heard as a judge, but also as an audience member at barbershop events. We're going to uncover a little bit about context. We're going to look at musical theme, look at uncovering the melody, uncovering the harmony, and then look at some arranging devices or embellishments that go into play when it comes to interpreting our music. Firstly, some observations that I've had over the years. The first is that we often overinterpret as barbershoppers. Now, that may just be because someone has told us that something should sound a little bit different, or it'd be great if it sounded different, or this phrase should be different to that phrase, but we often overdo it. A lot of the time, what we need to be doing from an interpretation point of view and from a musicality point of view is already written into the music, and we often overinterpret that. we often over-dynamicize. Now, I believe that I have coined this term. And what I mean by that is dynamics for the sake of dynamics. There is so much about dynamics that's already built into the musical structure of the melody and the harmony that we're singing that sometimes we over-dynamicize things and add dynamics where dynamics are really not needed or are kind of counterproductive to the musical delivery of what we're doing. Another thing that I've seen is that we often mimic others. Definitely as a young barbershopper, as I was growing up, I was often listening to the greats on YouTube and going to international and hearing all this amazing music. And more often than not, the way that I looked at presenting music was listening to what someone else did and then replicating it. Now, sure, this is a great option because there's some great choices being made by these groups. However, we've got to remember that the musical interpretation that they have come up with is theirs. And it's not necessarily ours. And it might be ours if we understand the context behind which that those decisions have been made and those ideas have been chosen. Another thing I've realized is that we often make fairly unmusical decisions to satisfy our misunderstanding of the judging categories. Now, I say this because historically I've seen a lot of people during evaluations who've come to me with questions and queries, and I've kind of shocked them when my answer's often been, no, that you don't need to do that. Now, I think that we have to be aware that when we're judging from the music judge's point of view, we're looking for good music. We're not necessarily looking for you to make any particular stylistic decisions unless they aid in good music. So I've often seen people who get confused by what the judge is looking for. And in the end, the judge is looking for good music, so we should all be striving for good music as well. Now, in terms of uncovering context, this quote is probably one of my favorite that I've ever come across. This quote was given to me by the wonderful Gary Bowles, who's part New Zealand, part from Las Vegas in the US, where he lives between those two. And the quote is, "You are the humble servant of the music and the faithful messenger of the composer." I'll say it again. "You are the humble servant of the music and the faithful messenger of the composer." It's as simple and easy as that. That quote was written on a little plaque on an upright piano that was owned by a wonderful man called Lou Perry, who was one of the giants of our style in terms of arrangement and creation of music. And that piano moved around wherever he went, and this little quote was always there. And I think it's really important that, for me anyway, that I remember the simple message of this, that in the end, we're not in service to ourselves or anyone else, except for the music and the message of the composer who wrote the music. I'm going to play you a song now, and the lyrics are up on the screen. I just want you to sit back and enjoy this and read along with the lyrics if you'd like. However, if you know this already, feel free to sit back and close your eyes and enjoy this wonderful performance of Smiling Through.
There's a little brown road winding over the hill to a little white cart by the sea. There's a little green gate at whose trellis I wait, while two eyes of blue come smiling through at me. There's a gray lock or two in the brown of her hair. There's some silver in mine too, I see. But in all the long years, when the clouds brought their tears, those two eyes of blue cast smiling through. this world all alone. I shall wait for my call patiently.
Both lyrics and music. Now, Arthur Penn was a composer and lyricist who lived over in Boston in the US. He actually had a house out on an island called Block Island, which is just off the coast of the US. And each day he would go back to the mainland, well, not each day, every couple of days generally, back to the mainland to work. And then he would return to Block Island, where there was a house that looks just like this. It's nicknamed Smilin' Threw. That house still stands there today, and many barbershoppers make a pilgrimage out to this house. Now, the reason that I talk about this song is that this story is kind of wonderful in that it does have a place and a person. And understanding the context of this place and that person in regards to this song is really important when we look at the music that we sing. Let's dive into musical theme. The theme is the principal musical statement of a song. It may be based on the song's rhythm, melody, or harmony, or a combination of these elements. The theme may vary from one part of the song to another, and there may be more than one theme present simultaneously. Now, I think it's important to note that when I first started judging in the music category, and I must say these elements that I'm reading out now are taken from our category description. When I first started judging, there was a lot of push that there was usually one theme behind the music that we were listening to. However, we've realized that these days, so many different elements musically go into making a piece of music fantastic. So a combination of these elements is definitely something that we hear and are looking for more often than not. The theme may also be a parody of one or more of the song elements. Okay, so I've got a bunch of examples here, and I'm hoping that through the wonders of our chat function, I might be able to get some responses from people. Now, I just want to remind you that we just listed a couple of different themes. Now, those themes were lyric, rhythm, melody, harmony, or a combination of. So what I'd love is when I play these musical examples is to get a bit of an idea from people, the kind of theme they're feeling in these moments. Now, the easiest way for me to describe theme and the way that I look at theme when I'm listening to music is what is the visceral reaction that I have when I hear a song or a piece of music? Is it to tap my foot? Maybe that would be the rhythm. Is it to hum the melody as I'm walking around the room? Maybe that would be to do the melody. Or am I moved emotionally by the lyric delivery of the song? All right, some of these aren't barbershop and some of them aren't even vocal tracks, but we're gonna have a little listen, and I'd like you to obviously take a listen to the piece of music and enjoy it, but have a think about what your body does when it reacts to this, to decide what themes may be present in this music.
With a beat, beat, beat of a heartbeat and a bang, bang, bang in my brain.
got a girl that's driving me crazy, and I think I'm gonna go insane. You think love's a fool's game? Well, buddy, maybe you're right. Got a girl that's driving me crazy, and I think I'm gonna see you tonight. Cause it's the blue eyes and all the girly charms. And now tonight's the night, she's in my arms. Yes, in my arms.
One day you'll find it. Driving rhythm, rhythm predominates, and bopping. Absolutely. So one of the first things you do is you want to groove with that. It's a lot in the way they deliver that as well. Cool. Let's try this one.
Just try it, and I'll start a riot. Beatrice Fairfax, don't you dare ever tell me he will care. I'm certain it's the final curtain. But not for me. A lucky star's above, but not for me.
With love. I love to play all these songs, but we'll be here for so long. I picked some of my favorite songs. So it shifts to a bopping rhythm. So this is a real combination of things. I had a couple of people in the chat say harmony, and I think that this is a pretty cool example where they're really milking these really dissonant and beautiful harmonies for everything they're worth. And I would say that there is an emphasis on the lyric, but more from the point of view of the delivery of prose or of the story. And then it really shifts to a nice, strong rhythmic theme that drives the whole way home. Okay, here's another example.
Stars out tonight. I don't know if it's cloudy or bright, 'cause I only have eyes for you, dear.
Again, another one of my favorite tracks, Jamie Cullum there. This one's interesting. I agree with everything that everyone said, but we're diverging a little bit away from the theme. So Chris, you said your visceral rhythm moving into classical lyric. Yeah, I kind of agree that we start with this rhythm. In fact, I usually play this track for people and ask them to tell me where beat one is before the bass line comes in, because it's a bit ambiguous. What I find with this arrangement is that there's so much going on that necessarily isn't on the beat or it's anything to do with the beat, that the thing that I am glued to is the melody, for me personally, when I hear it. But I agree there is that groove that people felt, and then there is a real hook on the melody and the lyric as it comes in. Here's another one.
Okay, this one's for Gabby.
Ooh. Excellent. I would completely agree with everyone who's saying that it's elements of rhythm and melody. And I think we're presented here with such a recognizable melody that's just so well constructed. Obviously, this is a mashup of two different melodies, but there's definitely that sense of rhythmic drive and purpose throughout it as well. It's a really lovely combination of the two. I'm just going to jump in the Q&A to see a couple of questions. Yeah, you do just want to sing along. I completely agree. all right, here's another example. Great, I see a lot of rhythms coming through. I don't know about you, but I started tapping my foot straight away. It's such a brilliant execution of tempo and meter. They did such a great job. Rodrigo y Gabriela guitar duo. So fun. All right, here's another one.
Over in Killarney, many years ago, my mother sang a song to me in tones so sweet and low. Just a simple little ditty in a good old Irish way, and I'd give the world if she could. That song to me this day, Tooraloora.
And we'll leave it there. So there's definitely elements of that lyric coming through in the exposition of what's happening in the song at the beginning, then also in the middle. But then when we're presented with this beautiful melody, which is that beautiful Irish lullaby, that's the thing we're going to want go away humming in my mind. Yes, I realize that you can't hear me when the music is playing. Thank you very much. And Rich has just asked, surely harmony is always the core theme in Barbershop. Now, yes and no. The harmony we sing is at the core of what we do. But from a musical theme point of view, it can't be the only thing that we explore. Harmony is kind of given in that, you know, we're singing constant four-part harmony, and that's a given. This is an extra layer on top of that, if you will.
When lovers sing together and never grow
again. I hate to stop it. So we've had a suggestion of harmony. Someone said this is a mixed bag. The melody is not predominant. The harmony elicits an emotional response. There's a lot of anticipation in the story. The way that the Westminster Chorus delivered this song in my mind is very much all around where that what the lyric is saying. This poetry in this song is the most important thing in my mind. And the way they choose to sing the song means that every lyric is so clearly understood, and the drive and the lift and the pull and the tension release is constantly supporting what the melody is doing, sorry, what the lyric is doing, and in fact, what the lyric has done to inform the melody. Here's another one.
Sky may be starless, the night may be moonless, but deep in my heart there's a glow for, deep in my heart I know that you love me. So near while apart. I'm not alone.
Again, I could keep playing that. That's Diana Krall. The way she sings that song is just absolutely stunning. And the way she sings in general is just stunning. And I love the way that that arrangement is constructed, in that she's able to pull and play with the melody and deliver that melody so beautifully with such a strong tie to the way the lyrics roll out. Just a couple more and we'll move on. I feel like we all know that song, so I'm going to skip ahead. That one was mainly put in there as a bit of a red herring. Remember that these terms that we're using to describe musical theme, a lot relates to music we sing, but they can be related to other music just because it is about that visceral reaction. So from that one, again, the melody from that one is just so hauntingly beautiful and does really sit with us after we've heard it. And one more.
Bird flying high, you know how I feel. Sun in the sky, you know how I feel. Breeze drifting by. It's a new dawn.
I'm so excited, so listen up while I say, well,
fish in the sea, yeah, you know how I feel. River running free, you know how I feel.
So that one, there's a definite big combination of elements. And yeah, some beautiful harmonies and a lot to do with the lyric at the beginning. And then it shifts to a bit of a real rhythmic drive. I always forget that I put that one in there. That's actually one of my quartet singing. How self-fulfilling. It's just a great arrangement and a great song, feeling good. All right, let's plow ahead. So how can we support the theme in the way we deliver music? Well, we could do it through the lyric. The lyric must ensure that the arrangement and the performance enhances the message by highlighting the lyric's critical words and phrases. So we can support the theme with its lyric by highlighting lyric's critical words and phrases. If we're looking at the rhythm, it should be supported by precision, clear articulation, appropriately chosen and well-defined tempos and tempo changes, and accurate executions of rhythms. If it's the melody, When the melody is a theme, we're looking usually at a melody that has such beautiful shape and contour, and that the dimensions of that melody can become more dominant than the lyrics themselves. So it's important then to use the melodic shape and contour, use volume levels and word colour and vocal quality and section and pace to ensure that the melody is at the forefront of what we're doing. As I said before, harmony can be a theme, even though obviously the harmony that we sing is so important. If the harmony is a theme, and it's pretty rare that it is, it's usually when it's more important than anything else. And it usually is only in fleeting moments, I've found. This is usually when the melodic construction and harmonic rhythm allow substantial opportunities for harmonic embellishment. So lots of extra fun, juicy chords that really predominate our experience of the song. Harmonic theme is supported by a high level of in-tune, locked and ringing sound. Sorry, my bad. Let me just jump back. One important thing to note is that there's another word that appears on the top of the music sheet called embellishment. And we've discovered that embellishment cannot in itself be a theme, but often is something that really aids in the delivery of the other themes. So being sure not to make the embellishment the theme. However, embellishments in a rhythm song really helps keep the tempo driving, and embellishments in a more lyrically driven song often help to support the lyric that we're singing. Okay. So why theme is important? Here are two versions of the same song sung by two very different artists. I'm just going to play a little bit of each of them. And I would love you to just throw some words in the chat that describe the way they make you feel. Not necessarily about theme, but to describe the way they make you feel. This is the first one, The Way You Look Tonight by Frank Sinatra.
Someday, when I'm awfully low, when the world is cold, I will feel a glow just thinking of you and the way you look tonight. Yes, your love.
Wonderful. So quite a different version than I think the one that we're used to hearing, which is a little bit more ballad freeform. But definitely it's got a real relaxed vibe. It's very happy and uplifting. You feel good. You definitely feel good when you're listening to it. Yes, it is very, very effortless. And it just feels so natural the way he sings it. All right. Here's the same song again, but a little different. Tony Bennett.
Someday, when I'm awfully low, when the world is cold, I will feel a glow just thinking of you and the way you look tonight.
Such a beautiful voice and such a beautiful delivery of that song. But yeah, very different. So people are feeling a little bit sadder and moodier. It feels a little bit more real for some people, a bit more reflective. And I agree. Rob Lee said Frank's on the hunt and Tony is reflective. And that's the way I kind of looked at it. I kind of feel that the Frank Sinatra version is like he's just found new love, or he's on the lookout for new love. Whereas Tony Bennett is reflecting on old love in his rendition of the song. Now, it's interesting that Frank's, the reason we feel happy and peppy and that it's new and fresh is a lot to do with the fact that it's so rhythmically driven the whole way through. He's chosen for that rhythm to be a driver the whole way through that song, whereas Tony Bennett's taken the back seat and thought, how can I make people feel that I felt something in my life? That's my take on it anyway, but just an important thing for us to remember that you can approach the same song quite differently, and get a different reaction and a different feeling out of the people that you're singing to. All right, Let's talk about tension and release. And why is tension and release so important? It's one of the fundamentals of barbershop. In the music category, we talk about it as unity and contrast, but tension and release is so vital in the music that we sing. It's intrinsic in the harmony that we sing. I'd be hard-pressed to find someone that wouldn't be able to sing the end of this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And if I left you there, you'd get annoyed. 8. That tension that's in that number 7 of the scale is important in music, as is that dominant seventh chord, the barbershop seventh chord that we hear so often. So we can hear the tension release in melody as things rise and fall or in larger intervals. We can hear it in our harmony. You can definitely hear it in our harmony. There's so many chords that want to resolve somewhere. And if I had you all in the room, I'd ask you to sing, but we can't do that right now. There's so much that can be brought around tension and release by the rhythm, either whether it gets faster or slower, whether rhythm is more frantic, whether there are more or less embellishments. We can get a lot of tension released by dynamics, either big jumps in dynamics or slow builds in dynamics or softer dynamics on particular moments that require a little bit more delicacy and attention. Then obviously there's tension and the release from the emotional or thematic content of the music, which comes a lot from our lyrics. I want to play you a couple of great examples of tension release. The first one is not in English, but for me is such a brilliant musical example of tension release in action. Here it is. That is the wrong example. That one's definitely in English. Let me try that again. Feel a sense of destination and arrival when we get to that last chord. That bass is huge. For me, like I get every time I've listened to that so many times, when you get to that final resolve on that chord, and that's only the first opening section of it, there's this wash of release that comes over you when you get there. Here's another one. That's technically a resolution there, but it so instantly doesn't resolve just after that. It's a wonderful example of building tension to a beautiful resolution that then moves on again. If we had time, I would play that whole thing because it is such a stunning use of tension and release and really tying into all the elements that make up a wonderful sense of tension and release in the music that we sing. So how do we uncover our melody? A very wise coach once said to me, how can you harmonize to a melody you do not know? And that's not only important for us as harmony singers like myself who sings tenor or baritone. It's important because the melody tells us so much about how the song should be delivered and how we should go about interpreting the music. Now, how does it do that? Well, it does that because of the lyrics, but then it also does that from the contour of the melody. In general, if a melody starts to rise or if any music starts to get higher, it's generally going to be louder, just especially in vocal music. It's the way our voices work. And when things get lower, it generally gets softer. So we've really got to understand the contour of our melody, to understand dynamics as much as pace as well. As things get higher and build it, you can hear that in that last arrangement of You Love Me, Really Love Me. As we built higher and higher, not only did they get louder, but they also got faster in their anticipation and delivery of that music. We can look at peak and flow. Where are there moments of real excitement, and where are there moments that it can relax and kind of just flow along beautifully? Then we could also look at the context as well, because there is always some context in a song. And it's nice to research the song. I might address that question. Oh, it's gone. Richard had a question there earlier in the Q&A around that the story I told you of the house. Now, for me, I would want to know information like the house on Block Island. And for me, when I sing music, I generally like to take some time to research the song a little bit, look into who wrote it, why they wrote it, because it's so important to understand the intent behind the music. And intent is the next thing on my list. Now, I will say that sometimes finding out the context behind a song is harder and possible. So you will need to develop your own story and prose, and you always will develop your own story and prose around why something might have happened or why it exists. Because songs do take on a new life with us as listeners as much as they do by the composer themselves. Sorry, I'm just checking Richard's comment. I don't really understand that question, Richard. You may need to rephrase for me. I'm so sorry. I'm just going to leave that and keep going on. But please do retype. I just don't necessarily understand what you're asking me to tell you. Sorry. All right. So here's a melody that I very, very much like. You've just heard a couple of artists sing. Now, if I had you in the room together, we would sing through this wonderful piece of music. But instead, we're just going to take a look at it. Let's take a look at some of the musical devices that have been built into this. So this has been written out in the key of E flat, and I'm hoping you can see my cursor on the screen. The word on day in bar two is an E flat. You'll notice that that's the kind of the home base where we start, and it's also the place that we end each of our phrases as well, which is kind of cool thing that we're always starting and going back to home base again. The other thing that's great about this melody is it has some wonderful progressions. We get someday when I'm awfully low, da 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 da, da 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 da, which is also home base as well. That beautiful sense of progression that builds and builds and then peaks on home base at the end of you, just the way you look tonight, and back to home base again. I think this is a really brilliantly constructed melody for a number of reasons. It's quite singable. In that it fits within an octave most of the time. The progressions also make it quite easy to sing, but they also provide a huge amount of anticipation in the way we can deliver it. The fact that we go back to home base at beginning and end of phrase is a great way to round out the phrases as we get there each time. Stunning melody, and sung so differently by so many different people. Just going to check Q&A just again. Richard, I'll just ask you a question, which was regarding listening to a group who's singing a song that has a melody that you might not know. I'm more referring, and I'm sorry if that wasn't clear, to when you're approaching learning a song yourself in your ensemble, that it's important for you to know the melody before you can start learning the other parts, so you have a fairer understanding of how it goes and then how the song is constructed around it. I hope that made sense. Please let me know if it didn't. Wonderful, it did. Thank you, Richard. So in terms of uncovering the harmony, without the harmony, we're kind of painting with only one colour. And although black and white paintings are great, we're in the industry and barbershop of painting with many different colours, and we've got so many up our sleeve when it comes to harmony. So I'm going to play a few chords, and we don't need to say it out loud, but I'd just like to ask you to reflect yourselves on what kind of feeling, emotion, thoughts you get in your head when you hear each of these chords play. Here's the major triad. Sorry that it's not a beautiful ensemble singing that for you. Have a think about what kind of image that conjures up in your head. What about this one? How about the diminished triad? Spooky. The augmented triad? The dominant seventh, our barbershop seventh. What does this make you feel? It's very different to the last couple of chords we just heard, isn't it? Hear that again? Oh, we do love that chord, don't we? What about the major seventh? For some reason, whenever I hear the major seven chord, I just imagine a giant expanse of water in front of me. There's something very ethereal and serene about that chord. Then the minor seventh. A half diminished seventh. So beautiful. And finally, our diminished seventh. So hopefully in hearing each of those, you felt something a little different. And each of them definitely conjures up a different feeling and emotion for me, whether that be of happiness, confusion, wonder, anticipation. There are so many different feelings that those chords may bring up for you if it was a wonderful ensemble, or maybe even something other than a MIDI honky-tonk piano playing for you. It's important to remember that back in the days of Beethoven and Mozart, that a lot of the time music was written in a particular key because it was believed that that particular key conjured up some kind of emotional content. So similarly, the chords we sing today definitely can conjure up a certain type of emotional response. And your arrangers are very diligent about making sure that they put the chords that conjure up the right kind of response at the right kind of moments within the arrangements we sing. And a lot of the time, some of those more exotic and funky chords are the ones we might want to hold and ring a little longer because they do have a different sense of emotional content as we're singing. Here's a chord progression. Have a listen to this. I realize I haven't got my other example in here. I'll have to find it in 1 second. Have a listen to this and feel the journey that we go on. This is the circle of fifths, our fabled circle of fifths. Have a listen. Now, I played that this morning for a chorus in the US when I was talking about the music category, and I said, name that song. And people's response was that it could have been really any polecat or any classic song that we sing. It's a pretty standard chord progression. I'm going to play that again, and unfortunately, my example jumped off the screen. I'm going to find that for you. So I'm going to play that again for you. Here we go. Oh, no, it doesn't like the joint. And now to play you the original example of that, let me find it very quickly. That song is this one.
Eyes of blue, but oh, what those 5 foot could do. Has anybody seen my gal?
Hopefully you heard that. I'm not sure whether you did or not. Can you just let me know in the chat if you heard it? Wonderful. The wonderful 5 foot
two, eyes of blue, but oh, what those 5 foot could do. Has anybody seen my gal?
Wonderful. All right. Moving right along. Embellishment. Now, I think we all have a fairly good understanding of what embellishments might be, but just to remind you, embellishments are one of the hallmarks of our barbershop style. The two hallmarks that are talked about the most are consonant harmony and embellishment. So embellishments come in many forms, and they may be swipes or echoes or key changes or bell chords, patter effects, back time, solo or duet passages, or solo with neutral syllable backgrounds and tags. tags and keychains and all those things are part of this banner of embellishments, which we all regard as a hallmark of the style. Now, the reason that we do regard them so highly is because what makes our music wonderful is that it is a cappella. And it is sung by just four voices who have to take on often the role of so many other instruments and people in an ensemble. Think about our songs like The Way You Look Tonight, as sung by Tony Bennett and Frank Sinatra earlier. They had a band backing them. So the embellishments make up all those band moments and go towards making a wonderful piece of music. The level of embellishment should be sufficient to propel the song, sustain musical interest, supporting the theme and providing a satisfying proportion of unity and contrast. So we definitely find that our embellishments should support what we're doing and propel the music forward and provide a lot of that unity and contrast that we get in our music. Embellishments are used to enhance the song's theme and delivery. All right, let's have a look at a couple of embellishments so we're aware of what they look like. Here's a swipe. Now, when someone says swipe, I think this is often a confused term. The easiest way to remember what a swipe is where a chord changes when there's one word happening. So this is from Genie with the Light Brown Hair. And this moment here is when we hold the word glow and the chord moves. We call that a swipe. Now, it's a great way for creating some tension as we get towards a resolution, especially that one right there, if you know this particular arrangement, is a fantastic example of creating tension in the moment. I Only Vise For You. Here's a classic one here as well. When we get to the from view and out of that wonderful E, this wonderful harmony evolves and slides down to this nice seventh chord at the end of that O. Echoes. This one is very self-explanatory as we get so many of these in our music, and often it's at times when we're ensuring that when the band would have been playing, that there's something going on around the melody to support the delivery of the melody. So this is from Once Upon a Time, arranged by Rob Campbell. Here's another example from Sweet Georgia Brown, arranged by Ed Waishey. And this is towards the end of the song as we're really ramping up to bring it home towards the tag. And this is almost like the play out, the coda. You can see that he's put stomp on there. So all these little echoes that are happening here are just to reinforce this really driving, fun rhythm that we rock out towards the end of the song. Key changes. Here's one from Good Luck Charm. You can see the key change on the screen. Just Want to Hold You Tonight. This is moving into the second verse. So a key change can be for many reasons, but usually it's to heighten what we've already been talking about and to add a new layer. This particular example takes us into that second verse in a whole new key and a whole fresh flavor. Here's a wonderful arrangement of Stranger in Paradise by Rob Campbell and Mark Hale. This is one that the Masters of Harmony won with some years ago now, and an arrangement I was very, very lucky to sing at the Masters of Harmony rehearsal when Mark Hale was directing his final rehearsal. There's two key changes in the space of about 9 bars here, and it's two of the most spectacularly difficult but spectacularly beautiful key changes that lead us on this beautiful harmonic journey towards the end of this song. Bell chords. We see them from time to time. They were definitely a feature of our music more often back in the day, but we do get them now because they're a great little addition, especially in transitions, key changes, just to add a little bit more punch to a particular lyric or to give us a bit more drive rhythmically as well. This one's a great example from Told 'Em All About You, You Dear Medley, as sung by Bluegrass Student Union. There's another one from Smile Medley, one that's been sung a bit more recently, arranged by Clay Hine. Obviously, solo passages are something we use from a lot of the time. Obviously, we never want to do it for too long a period of time because we're always trying to aim to have as much four-part consonant harmony we have. But having a solo passage, just like this one from Driving Me Crazy, a song written and arranged by Bob Dizzy, it's a great opportunity for us to provide a little bit of contrast to the text you have had the rest of the time and also feature the melody and feature the lyric in the melody through particular sections. All right. Well, we would put it all together, and unfortunately, I couldn't go to the next slide when we're doing this session online, as I want everyone to sing, and until they fix the internet, right? They can fix the internet and make the latency work. No, they can't. Until we can all be back together, we won't be able to sing. But that brings me to the end of Uncovering the Music. Thank you so much, everyone.
Thanks, Alex. As I find my unmute button and turn my video back on. Thanks again, Alex. That was a great session. We really appreciate you taking the time to put that together and present for us tonight. Now, everyone, please keep an eye on our YouTube channel. Tonight's session will be uploaded there in the coming days. All of our previous BHA Live sessions are also available there, so please check them out by going to YouTube, searching for Barbershop Harmony Australia, or just go to the BHA website and follow the links on the homepage. I'll also put a couple of links in the chat now. You can save them. Now, next week, we have a return visit from Australian barbershop icon Ian Mulholland. He's going to be taking us through everything you need to know to get started with sightseeing. So if you've ever wondered how to get started in this space, this is a session that you do not want to miss. So the registration link is up already. Just visit, as I mentioned earlier, the BHA Live page on the Barbershop Harmony Australia website. A huge thanks again to Alex for tonight's session, and thank you to all of you for watching. Have a great weekend. We'll see you all next week.